God is here.
Hello, and welcome to The Gathering. Now, as you know, this is our on-demand worship service, and so that means you can access it starting March the 23rd. You can access this service from wherever you are, in your home. You can gather a bunch of people together to watch this, but you have the freedom to watch it when you wish and from wherever you wish. But remember, for this particular service, it won't be available to you until March the 23rd. Now, just a note, we are going to be celebrating Holy Communion this evening. So I want to remind you, perhaps just take a couple of seconds to grab some elements for communion, maybe a little piece of bread or a cracker, and perhaps some grape juice or whatever type of juice you might have in your house at this time. Grab it and set it aside, because later on in this service, we are going to join God at his table and have Holy Communion. Will you join me in prayer? Oh, gracious God, pour out upon us your grace. Pour out upon us your love. Pour out upon us your Holy Spirit, oh God. Help us to feel your word. Help us to know that that word is a light and a lamp to our feet this day, oh God. And it is in your Son's name that we pray this, O Lord. Amen.
Again, we welcome you to The Gathering. Thank you so much for tuning in from wherever you are. We now find ourselves in the third week of Lent. Lent is a time in our church calendar where we prepare ourselves for the tragedy of the cross and for the victory of Jesus' resurrection. So for today for Lent, we're going to be doing a hymn sing. We're going to be singing some hymns that are going to be familiar to you, but in a slightly different way. I would like to dedicate some of these hymns to one of my first mentors, the late, amazing Faye Bailey Johnson, who used to tell me anytime I complained about songs, she would say, "Rashad, you got to learn those hymns." So we're going to do this and dedicate it to the late Faye Bailey Johnson.
Oh,
watching over.
Watching over.
Yeah.
Watching over, honey.
Watching over.
Watching over.
Yeah.
Watching over.
Can you say that? Watching over.
Watching over.
Yes, he is.
Watching over, honey.
Oh, watching over.
Watching over.
Yeah.
Watching over, honey.
The Lord sits high. And he looks down
watching
below.
Over,
and he's watching over.
Watching over.
Oh, watching over.
Watching over,
say he's watching over.
Watching over,
watching over,
oh, watching
over, watching over, oh, watching over,
watching over.
Well, tonight, we're doing something special. We're going to talk about something crazy that Marble does. Now, when I first arrived at Marble, and I heard about the Easter offering, I heard that this church takes the largest offering it receives during any Sunday of the year, and it gives it all away. And not only does it give it away, people get so excited about giving away, they give even more. And so tonight, I want to talk about this crazy phenomenon called the Easter offering, and offer in the midst of this just a little reflection about why it's so important. And to help me do this, I have two very special people from Marble. I have Janet Piero and Barbara Sagan. They're both on the bomb committee, the committee that's the bomb. I don't think anybody says that anymore, right? Does anybody say the bomb anymore? I don't think so. It's long gone. That's what I thought. I think it came into vogue long after I was young, to be honest. So bomb is Benevolence Outreach and Missions. And they really help shepherd the process for the Easter offering. And so tonight we're going to talk about this. And first I want you to tell me a little bit, if you could, how did we ever begin doing this? Whose crazy idea it was to say, let's take this big offering and give it away?
Well, I'll start. The Easter offering, as it is now known, was initiated by the Young People's Ministry of Marble Collegiate Church.
Because they thought it was the bomb. Yeah. Now I'm going to give that up now.
And they began in 1968. They decided that it was time for them to raise money to give to nonprofit organizations in the United States, nationally and internationally, that were serving vulnerable communities. And so, doing our research, I found out that what they did as a group, they gave up their money that they spent every week for restaurants, for theaters, and for socialization, and then they also encouraged the congregants of the church to give. And that year, this young group raised $12,000.
In 1968?
In 1968.
Wow.
And they were able to give money to 10 nonprofit organizations. And then in the early 70s, the title was changed. Oh, it was called Lenten Day.
Okay, Lenten Day.
Uh-huh. And 1970, the name was changed to the Easter Offering, which we now have today. But the goals and objectives are just the same.
That is so great. And why do you think people got so excited about this that they adopted it church-wide? Or put another way, what excites you about the fact that we do this?
I think it's what's so exciting about it is all of the money goes to the organizations that we fund. Marble keeps none of the money, and the organizations that we select to get Easter Offering grants are vetted by the bomb committee or the benevolence committee. And the benevolence committee is comprised of people who have come from varied backgrounds and have knowledge about finance and nonprofits. And these people are their applications are submitted and they're vetted and there are site visits so that when you're giving to the Easter Offering, you can have the confidence that you're giving to organizations that really do give the money to their target population, that the Easter Offering grant makes a difference in their work.
So as I understand it, I mean, the committee members divide up and that you really take time getting to know the organizations that we eventually support, right?
Yes. Before the pandemic, we did site visits to go out and really see what the organization is doing and how they're doing it.
That's amazing.
And some of us called during the year.
That's great. And it's great the tradition continues. Now, tell us about some of the organizations or the type of organizations that we support through the Easter Offering.
Well, we cover a range of areas. We cover food and hunger, we cover education, we cover health, and we cover shelter. And anything that would make a difference in people who's underprivileged or who don't have the ability to do well in all of these areas. And we try to select representative organizations from each of these areas. And in that way, you know, deliver the funds to where they're needed.
And we have added social justice to our list as well.
That's great. That's really a priority in today's world. And in fact, I think some of the organizations we already supported were already dealing with some justice issues, but we're becoming, I think, more centered on finding ways to bring about equity and equality in the world.
Right.
That's great. You know, as I think about all of this, and as you think about this, how important this is, I just wanted to offer a little reflection about why I think this is so important. And of all things, it was Proverbs 18:16 that came to mind. It's a simple little verse. It says, a gift opens doors. It gives access to the great. Now, on one level, I think there's three levels of meaning to this. One level that just means, if you want to talk to important people, come with a gift. And so I remember when we lived in Oman, the Sultan would do a little tour each year, and he would go to different regions of the country to meet the people. And you know who the people were that got to see the Sultan? The people that brought gifts. If you wrote a poem, poetry's huge in Arabic society. If you brought a poem to offer, if you brought some type of gift that was indicative of your region, you probably got to see the Sultan. So in a sense, it's just kind of a truth about the world. But I think there's another level of meaning if we personalize it. A gift opens doors, it gives access to the great. I think we all discover that when we give, that it opens doors to greatness for us in the sense that we realize what's truly important and what matters most, what truly is great to do in this world. And so I think when we give, it opens doors for us to truly see the world differently, to see people differently, to see what's great and important in this world. But then I was thinking about the Easter Offering and the impact it makes, and it led me to conclude there's probably another level of meaning here, a third level. And it's this, that a gift opens doors for whom? For those to whom we give it, and it gives them access to the great. Meaning there's so many things that they can do in life if only they have the resources and the help to be able to do it. And when you give that gift, it's like opening up a door for them to the great, to what God has in store for them that they otherwise wouldn't have.
That is true.
And so for me, I think this verse just captured so much for me in thinking about the Easter Offering. And in line with that, what I'd love to do is hear, like, what are some of your favorite stories about people who have received help from the Easter Offering through the organizations we support? Remind you again, every single dollar you give goes to these organizations. For me, I was thinking about this as you think about it. There are two stories came to mind. And one is we help people who are children of those who are incarcerated. And I remember hearing from a young woman whose mother was incarcerated, a single parent home. She had to take care of the younger children. And because of the support she received, she was able to care for the children, to get her education, and finally get a job. And when she was telling this, I mean, it seemed so far from reality that she would ever be able to do this with her life, But because of the support she could, she was in tears, I was in tears. I mean, I just could not believe the door it opened for her. And then I think about going to PS30. We have a tutoring program that we run there, and we provide funds to help organize it. And we've been tutoring 20 children at this school, elementary age. And I went there and we shot some video there, and it gave me a chance to read to the kids and get to know the kids and the teachers, and the tutors were there. And what was amazing to me is you often think of tutoring, you know, extra help in a subject, and the kids must dread it. The kids loved it. They absolutely loved it, because not only did it help them in whatever subject matter it was, but it let them know there's somebody else that cares. And the reputation of the program is so great that they have a line of kids and parents asking, when can my kid get a tutor? Because they want that kind of help and they want that kind of care. So it's just amazing to see the doors it opens for people.
And I think it's the one-on-one that you don't often get in these organizations. And when somebody is paying attention to you one-on-one, it makes such a difference in your life, and it gives you that extra confidence to maybe do something or try something that you hadn't before.
Oh, absolutely. The difference it can make to have one person believe in you, particularly when you're that age.
But our money opens up doors in so many different ways.
Yeah, what stories do you, or what are highlights for
this
you?
This is my door.
Okay.
We give to an organization called the Center for Hearing and Communication. And within 6 months, between 2020 and 2021, within 6 months, their mental health clinic increased by 38%. And for that year, we gave money that year to the mental health clinic. Within the year, they provided over 2,000 clinical hours, which was a tremendous increase. And they were able to hire another social worker. So that was a big opening, especially for hearing impaired people. And they were having to do it virtually. So as it turned out, the signers did better than the oral. But the idea that they were able to reach so many more people and provide therapy during this pandemic was wonderful, wonderful.
That's amazing, amazing. How about you, Barbara?
One of the doors that I see opened is through the organization Women for Afghan Women. This is an organization based in Queens, set up and run by women who lived in Afghanistan and then moved here to start the organization. And they sponsor an education program for women who are here with their husbands, who've come here because of jobs or because of the military. And you probably recall from the news, women in Afghanistan, because of the Taliban, could not go to school. So they really did not get an education. So when they come here with their husbands, they need to create a life for themselves and their children. So the Women for Afghan Women sponsors this education program. They help them with English as a second language. They help them with getting a driver's license, with just functioning. How do you function in the United States, in American society? One of the things they do is help them to become citizens. And becoming a citizen, you have to go through a whole course and take a test. And these women, I'm also actually a volunteer for this group. And I can't tell you how heartfelt it is to see these women learning the language and wanting to know about the Constitution and how our government operates, so that they then in turn can go out and start their own lives. And one woman who went through this program did exactly that. She was here with her daughter. She went through, got the citizenship, got a certificate for running a health program, started her own business, got her own home, so became, you know, independent and functioning in the society, which is, when you think about it, what you really want to do and what you want to do for those refugees and people coming here to our country. So,
could I give one more story?
Absolutely.
We also give money to an organization called Fresh Youth Initiative, mm-hmm. and we have been sponsoring what they call the Welcome Program, which is a program for 5-year-olds who are just coming into the country. No English, no nothing. And so last year we donated to the Welcome Program. But I got a call from the executive director and she said, we can't do it this year because we can't meet with the kids. Can I use the money? I said, use the money anywhere you need to use it. So they opened up a pantry right away. And they also took money to give to vouchers to the parents in Washington Heights. To go to the what they call the Hispanic pantries to get the kind of food they like. And they also strengthen their mental health services because they had minimal, but they needed it because the kids were losing parents and grandparents. So I was really thrilled about that. And I think the team was too.
Yeah, oh, definitely. Yeah. Absolutely, Janet. Yeah.
That's amazing. And what's so clear and what I think is so exciting is that this is about relationships, right? It's not about check writing, although the checks that go to them are very important. The dollars make a difference. But it's about relationships with the organization, relationships with the people. And I think that really makes a difference.
Big difference.
Now, as people consider giving to the Easter offering, what would you say to them as they consider whether they give and how much they give? Let's just assume it's going to be how much they give. Everyone wants to contribute to this.
It doesn't matter how much you give. You can give a dollar, you can give $1,000. The more that you can give, we certainly would appreciate that because that allows us to give the grants that we can give. But it really doesn't matter. And I think our theme this year is building bridges of hope and joy. We want the giving to feel joyous to you, to feel like you're really making a difference in people's lives, you're helping someone. And ultimately, it's Marble, the mission of Marble Church to be outreach, to have an outreach program that helps people. And so you should feel good about giving and know that the organizations that you're giving to have been cleared and they're ones that really merit the donation.
And I'd just like to ditto what Barbara's just said, because I've been around a long time. And I remember when they were talking about the Easter offering, and I thought, I can't pay dues and give money to the Easter offering. So then I decided, this month I'll give to the Easter offering, and I won't give to dues. I'll make it up next month. Now I'm a little better, so I give both during the month. But that was a consideration, because I really thought it was important to give to help others.
And it is. And you do what you can when you can, right? And know that it makes a difference. Well, thank you so much for being with me and us and sharing this. It's just exciting to see. And if you'll just stay here for a minute, I'd like to close with offering prayers for all the people and organizations this represents. So let's pray together. Oh, loving God, it's so clear that through this offering, your love is expressed in tangible ways. And sometimes we forget all the needs that are around us. We walk down the city streets and we pass people not recognizing what they face. People who have felt isolated during the pandemic and are struggling. People who have lost loved ones to COVID. Parents whose kids are behind because of the pandemic. Someone who just received a diagnosis and they're concerned. People who have just been discriminated against and wonder where to turn. Every day we pass people with needs. Let the Easter offering remind us of those needs and that we can respond in ways to make a difference. And let us remember to continue to hold one another in prayer and hold them in prayer, because we know prayer changes things, because prayer changes us. Be with us as we move forward with this. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
I am free. When I was down in my heart,
come to the time of Holy Communion. This is the time when I want to invite you to go grab your piece of cracker or your piece of bread and maybe your grape juice and join me for Holy Communion. We have before you God's table, and God has created a space for each one of us at this table. Everyone is welcome. This gives us an opportunity to affirm and reaffirm our inclusion in the body of Christ. And so we are reminded that on the night Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, he blessed it, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. And he said to his disciples, "Take, eat this. This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." At the same time, he took the cup and he said, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood. Whenever you drink this, do this also in remembrance of me." I want to invite those of you here to come forward to participate in the body and blood of Christ. I invite you now at home to join us, taking the body of Christ and partaking in that. And the blood of Christ.
Isn't the music amazing and doesn't it move you? Thank you so much to all of you. It really makes a difference and it really gives that spot of inspiration that we all need. And that's why we do the gathering. And I want to thank you for your support. Your support means so much to this ministry and we value your continued support. So if you want to continue to do so or make a contribution now, just go to the webpage and click on donate and every dollar makes a difference. And remember, watch for the Easter offering and participate in that because that really makes a difference in people's lives. Go to our website as well, marblechurch.org. I can get it out. There's so much happening at Marble, and there you can see all the many things we do and ways you can connect in a deeper way with us, and I hope you do so. And now, as you prepare to move into the day, move into the week, whenever you're watching this, know that the light and love, the grace and peace of Christ go with you. So whatever you face, Christ will see you through. Amen.
Second verse together.